for tomorrow's in your hands, and all I need you will provide, just like you always have, 'cause I'm fighting a battle that you've already won. No matter
Amen. Y'all can be seated for a moment. Good morning, everyone. My name's Owen. I'm the college minister here at Progression Church. And we just want to say welcome. We are so glad that you're here this morning, especially as we get ready to start a new teaching series. We just finished Thessalonians, which even though it's a smaller book, we were in there for a while. But we're going to start in Jonah today, and we're going to be 5 weeks in Jonah. And I am personally really excited for that because there are a few of those books and those stories, especially in the Old Testament, that we have a tendency to overlook. Especially if you grew up in church, you did like the little drawing of the whale, or maybe with Noah's Ark, you drew the animals on the ark, or whatever it is, and that's maybe like all you think about when you think of that story. But with Jonah, it's so much more than a whale or a big fish and Jonah being thrown overboard. It is really a microcosm of the gospel and the grace and sovereignty of God. So I'm really excited to get into that with you today with Pastor Brian showing us off. And one thing that really encourages me, especially about that last song, is that in Jonah, we're going to see a bunch of mess ups, a prophet of God who's supposed to be a godly man, he falls. Well, on top of that, we see God's grace. And at the end of the day, we know how the story ends. We know that at the end of the day, God's going to reign supreme over all things. And we even get a picture of that in Jonah. So that's something that we can celebrate. Like, no matter what we're going through, no matter the mistakes that we have made, we have a God who is steady and who does not change. And we get a cheat code and we can look at the end how it happens. So we're going to continue in worship. And as we do that, I just pray that you would truly like focus upon this God who is a steady thing, who is a sure thing, filled in a world that is bound to change. So I'm going to lead us in a short time of a prayer, and we're going to get back to worshiping God and then hearing from the Word of God. Let's pray. Take a moment just to thank God for how strong and steady and big He is. Thank God for His Word, that through His Word we know Him and we know how this story ends. And just ask God to help you focus and to worship Him. God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you that you are a God who is not surprised by the changes in the world, but how we are assured that you will reign supreme. We pray that as we continue in worship and hear your word, that you would draw us to yourself, keep us focused upon you, help us to give you the worship that only you deserve. In Jesus' name. Soul can stop its searching.
I believe that God so loved the world. Romans tells us, Paul writes us, and he says, anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. It doesn't matter your history, your past. And that's such a refreshing thought and truth, even for me as a believer, this morning, that anyone who calls on his name can be saved. And that calling upon the Lord, it's not just like saying Jesus' name like when you stub your toe. It's calling on his name from a heart that is full of faith, right? We can know everything about Jesus. We can know the stories of Jesus. We can know that he came to the earth. And we can know that he taught good things. And we can know that he died on the cross and rose from the grave. We can have that knowledge. But what God wants from us is faith. Faith to call on his name, knowing that it's not just what God did, it's what he's doing. And when he died on the cross, it wasn't just an act. He did it to save us from our sins, to rescue us. The Bible says that we were enemies of God before he saves us. We are his enemies. And we may be like, well, I'm not trying to be God's enemy. I'm trying to do some good stuff. I'm trying to do the right thing. But what happens is we sin. We're imperfect and we make mistakes. We do the wrong thing. We don't live up to God's standard. And he knows that. So he sent Jesus so that we no longer have to be enemies. But with a heart full of faith, we can call on his name for forgiveness, for mercy, for grace. And he brings us into his family as his children. No longer enemies. So we're going to continue worshiping, and I want us to really wrestle with that this morning, that we were enemies, but he brings us into his family if we know him, and we call on him in faith. He's good on his promises. He always makes good on them. So we're going to continue to sing that together this morning. Let's do it. time we sing, great is your faithfulness.
Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting sun, I will praise your name.
Yeah.
Great is your faithfulness to me.
Amen. You guys can be seated this morning. What's up, church? Anybody glad to be here today? We good?
Yes.
Man, that singing was good. And as you noticed from our video, we are in a new series. We'll be teaching through the book of Jonah for the next 5 weeks. And I tell you what, that was my favorite bumper I've ever seen in our church. All right? It was short. And one of our own made it. Andy Hayes, one of our students, made that for us. Praise God. Unleash your gifts, girl. That was awesome. So that's fun stuff. So we're going to be in Jonah. So if you want to follow in the Bible, we're going to be in the book of Jonah. That's in the Old Testament. All right? And we're going to be looking at Jonah chapter 1, and we're going to look at verses 1 through 3 today, all right? We're going to walk through the book in 5 weeks, and today we've got the shortest amount of scripture, but it sets up our whole study, so it's going to be good. But before we get there, let me kind of ask you this question. Can you think of anything that you misunderstood when you were a kid? Like, it just kind of went over your head, something you didn't understand when you were a kid. I don't know about you, if you had a bunch of those things. Almost everything pertaining to money went over my head as a kid, right? Like, how you got it, how much you needed to survive, all those kind of things went over my head. But one came to mind this week, and maybe it's still over a lot of our heads, and that was taxes, all right? When people talked about taxes as a kid, I didn't have any idea what was going on. Like, here's kind of an example of that. Whenever I was young, I don't remember how old I was pretty young. Our parish had this big thing where they were trying to pass a penny tax. That's what they called it, a penny tax, so that we could give the teachers in our parish a raise, all right? And this is a big deal. It's in all the newspapers, and my mom is a teacher, and most of my family on both sides of my family are teachers, so we're very big pro-educator. And I remember that being a thing. It's like, it was a big penny tax. I read about it, and then I saw people on the side of the road, and like, they'd have signs, and it would be like, vote yes for the penny tax, and vote no for the penny tax. And as a kid, I'm trying to figure out how taxes work and what's going on, and my deal is like, man, why are we giving so much trouble and effort over my mom getting a 1 cent raise? That's what I thought. I was like, she's getting a 1 penny raise. I'm just like, do we need to vote about this? Why are people angry at my mom for getting one more penny? Is it a day? Is it an hour? I didn't know what it was. And I remember telling my dad, I was like, I don't want to, everybody's just getting in the up in arms over mom getting one more penny. He's like, well, it's not really that she's going to get one more penny. It's that every dollar is going to be taxed 1% more. That's what we're going to give to the teachers. And I was like, oh, but even then as a kid, you don't think about big purchases, right? So you don't think how that would affect you, like buying a house or a car. All I could think of is I go to the grocery, I go to like the gas station and give them a dollar for a Powerade twice a week. So I'm gonna give 2 pennies to the teacher fund, you know? At the time I was like, let's just pass the hat. We could solve this without the government, you know? That's what I thought as a kid, because taxes just didn't make sense to me. I didn't understand how they worked, where the money went, how we got it, and why it was important. All I knew is if I complained about it against all around older people, they thought I was awesome, right? I'd be like, you know what? Death and taxes, you know what I'm saying? And they were like, this guy gets it, all right? This third grader's going places. I knew that worked, you know? So that's about what I knew about taxes as a kid. It went over my head. And I tell you that because we're about to study the book of Jonah. And look, if you grew up around church, this is something you probably heard about. If you haven't grown up around church, this is going to be a crazy book, all right? And I'm excited for us to get into it wherever we are on that spectrum. But I grew up going to church, and this is one of the first stories that I was taught. And whenever I learned the story of Jonah, there's a lot of spoiler alerts, which I think is okay if we're teaching the Bible, okay? So there's a lot of spoiler alerts today about what's going to happen in the book. But one of the things that happened is Jonah, this guy, is going to get swallowed by a big fish, all right? And that's kind of like what a lot of us remember about it. And it is a really cool part of the book. But I've learned now after studying as a grown-up, Jonah is less about a big fish and really is all about a big God, all right? And we're going to see that as we kind of dive in. What went over my head as a kid was all the nuances that's going on in this book, what's happening in this time, all the things that we're going to learn about, very grown-up things we're going to talk about over the next 5 weeks that I think are going to be good for us to wrestle with. But man, it's not as much about a big fish, though that is a really cool part of the story. It's really about a big God, okay? So we're going to see that as we go on. So let me kind of tell you a little bit about Jonah the person, all right? What do we know about Jonah the person? We know he is a prophet. We see in chapter 1, verse 1, it says, "The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai." All right? So we know that he has heard a word from the Lord. This is something kind of distinguished the word heard to a prophet. We also see in 2 Kings another time that we find out a little bit more information about him. So in 2 Kings, I believe chapter 14, we learn that he's a prophet to the people of Israel in the time of King Jeroboam, okay? And if you don't know much about King Jeroboam, you are welcome here. Most of us would not pass that quiz, all right? But King Jeroboam was a king to the northern kingdom, Israel, in the 700 BCs, and he wasn't one who necessarily followed God. He accomplished some things. God accomplished a few things through him, but he wasn't necessarily one who followed God very well. And Jonah was a prophet in those days during that king's reign, okay? So we see that he is a prophet, and a prophet at that day in the Old Testament was someone that God used to kind of speak on his behalf, kind of like he would move and he would give them word and they would share something to the people, all right? So that's who Jonah is. So he's a prophet by trade. This is his calling, his occupation. He's serving in the time of Jeroboam. Jeroboam's not really following God, but God's still using him because he's a good God who's faithful, things that we sang about earlier. And it says the word of God came to him. And then we're going to find out what God actually said to him. So if you want a title for today's message, I know some of you guys are organized and you like titles, all right? I have a title today, all right? And we actually have titles for the rest of the series. Thanks, Joe Handy. So this is what we got, all right? Running from God. Running from God. That's what we're going to be talking about today. And today I'm not going to give you points. I'm going to give you questions. I'm throwing everything out of order today, all right? No points, just questions as we walk through this text. And the first question is this, I want us to wrestle with as we learn about Jonah's beginnings here. And the first question for us is this, what are you running from? What are you running from? If you want to write down something today, that will be the first thing. What are you running from? Let's learn what Jonah's was. So it says in verse 1, it says, "The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai. Get up," this is God speaking to him, "get up. Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because their evil has come up before me." And Nineveh was a large city at the time. It was known for having these massive, impressive walls around the city. This was a time when the Assyrian Empire was on the uptick and was soon to do some tremendous things and overtaking a lot of things. And this is kind of a time whenever it was kind of at the center of all that. But in regards to Israel's relationship to Nineveh, it is not a good one, okay? These were enemies. This is someone that he probably would not have been happy to find out this assignment, okay? And he says, "Get up, go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because their evil has come up before me." So he told him, hey, go to your enemies and preach against them. That's a tough assignment. Can we be honest? It's a tough one. And not only is that, there's some geographical issues here too. So this is not like down the street at Chipotle, all right? God has told him to go 500 miles inland to go and do this, all right? But instead, Jonah does what we all do sometimes. He hears from God to do something, and he's going to literally try to do the exact opposite, right? So God tells him, get up, go to Nineveh and preach. Verse 3, he does this. Jonah got up to flee to Tarshish from the Lord's presence. He went down to Joppa, found a ship going to Tarshish. He paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish with the Lord, or from the Lord's presence. So what does that mean? What are we going on here? So we got to look a little map, okay, for Bible times as they help you out. So he's getting out on a boat in Joppa, and if he was going to go to Nineveh, that's about 550 miles. Me and my family are going to Florida for vacation. We're going to the beach after church today, okay? So it's a basically like driving to Gainesville, okay, which I know we're not big fans of today, all right? But if you drive from here to Gainesville, that's about how far it was. Where he was trying to go was Tarshish, which is 2,500 miles the opposite direction, all right? It wasn't like he was like, okay, well, I'll just kind of go hide in the woods. He's trying to go as far as he possibly can go on a boat at that time, all right, in the opposite direction. Like, if it's driving to Gainesville distance to get to Nineveh, this is like L.A. to New York. That's how far the distance is from where he is and where he's trying to go away from God. And it says that he's trying to flee from God's presence, from the presence of the Lord, which is one of those things whenever you read that, you're like, man, that feels like something that's not going to be able to be accomplished, right? You're not going to get away from the Lord's presence. This is what we know about God theologically. We would say this, that he's omnipresent, right? That there's never a place or time that he's distant from. But yet the prophet's like, hey, if I go 2,500 miles to the left, maybe God won't see me there. It's foolish, but we all do it sometimes. We hear from God, and we go as far away as we can in the opposite direction. For some of us, it may not be that God's calling us to go tell someone about Jesus in a faraway country, but it might be something like this, that God's calling us to forgive, and we're just not willing to do it. Or God's calling us to go talk to our friend at our workplace about Jesus, and it just is too awkward. It might be that we know we're called to do something in the church. Maybe it's get involved in a group or to serve or to be generous or to whatever, invite people. Like, we all have things that we know God has put on our heart to do, and sometimes don't we struggle to actually do them? And we may not literally get on a boat and leave, but sometimes what we do is essentially put God on red, right? We know he told us to do it. We just didn't do it either way. Just kind of sat there in the middle. And that's disobedience too. And I'll tell you what, I've had a lot of these moments. And I think about one time, the closest thing that I had to a literal Jonah moment was kind of close. When I was 14, I went to church camp. And if you've never gone to church camp as like a youth, as like a student, it's really a time where you go and it's like you got worship services and, you know, all these kids from different churches are there. You have Bible studies and you do fun stuff and you fall in love. That's kind of what happens, right? At almost every church camp. So this is my first time ever going. And I remember going and we went to this worship service the first night. And I remember this guy was preaching and his name was Brian. And he spelled it the right way with an I, not a Y, all right? And I was like, this guy's cool, you know? And I remember while I was preaching, I felt like a little conviction from God. I didn't really know what that felt like that much. I was already a believer. But I felt like God was kind of putting on my heart that what the guy was doing up there preaching was what I was supposed to do, right? And that's a picture of me going to church camp, all right? Bowl cut, eighth grade. Let's do this, you know? So, but I'm like, okay, I kind of feel this conviction that maybe this is what God's calling me to do. And I'm like, that can't be God. There's no way. Like, so I'm like, okay, the next night, you know, the guy's preaching and it's going good. And then I'm just telling God, I'm like, I know that's not you. There's no way that's what you're calling me to do. So then, like, people in the row in front of me turn around and they're like, hey, the guy preaching, he reminds us of you. And I'm like, okay, that's weird. All right. Put it in the coincidence side of things, though, right? So I'm like, yeah, you know, it's fine. And I remember talking to God. I was like, hey, you're going to have to make it crazy clear to me because I don't want to do this, all right? And the last night, Brian with an I, who told funny stories, who my people in front of us thought that I reminded them of, came out walking out preaching in the exact same orange structure shirt that I had on, all right? And I remember just looking at it and being like, all right, God, that's pretty close, right? It's pretty close, right? And let me tell you what I did. I felt strong conviction that God was calling me to ministry. And at 14, this is what I told God. I can't do it. I can't do it. I just don't want to. I'm not going to. And I left camp not having one of those cool moments when we told the whole church what God taught me. I was just like, I had fun playing basketball, right? And I felt like I knew God put something on my heart. And I just said no. And that began a time in my life when I started running
from God. In that area of my life, I just was like, I ain't doing it. I don't want to do it. I don't know anybody's a pastor. That does not look like a good job. I don't want to do it. And I don't know if you've been there before, but I think we all have. It may not be as, you know, crazy as like, hey, you got all these weird things lining up that maybe God's getting your attention. But we all have times when we hear the word preached, when we know we're supposed to do something that God wants us to do, and we run just like Jonah. So my question is today, what are you running from today? Here's the second question. Why are you running? Why are you running? If you've been around here very long, or if you're going to be here in the future, you'll probably hear this, say this a lot. Why is the most important question? The what's important, but the what's more a symptom. The why is the root. Why are you running? That's a good question, right? So why is Jonah running? He's trying to get out of town, man. What is he doing? He's going the opposite direction of where God is calling him to do. And you might think a lot of different reasons why we wouldn't do this. Why? It's dangerous, right? You're going into enemy lines, and your message that God is sending you with is you're all terrible, you need to repent, or God's going to destroy you, all right? And if you think that's just a paraphrase, read it. That's almost what he literally has to say to him. That seems dangerous. Or maybe it's just like he doesn't want to make the travel. It's 500 miles. He doesn't have a plane. He doesn't have a car. This is going to be an arduous journey. Or maybe it's just that he's scared of speaking, you know, kind of like Moses. He's just like, man, that's not going to be my thing. Luckily for us, in chapter 4, he kind of tells us why. His why at the beginning, it seems like he's trying to flee from the presence of God. Okay, he mentions that. But in chapter 4, verse 1 through 3, what happens? And this is going to be a huge spoiler, but hey, we can do that with the Bible. So what happens is, and we'll give all the details later, but he's eventually going to get to Nineveh, and he's going to preach that message. And this is what's going to happen. The Ninevites are going to repent. And God is not going to destroy them like he said that he would. And he sees this, in a moment, revival happen. And he gets to be the preacher that God uses to bring this revival to this people. And this is an amazing time in Israel's history, because this is rarely, if never, happened, that we see that God is sending this preacher from the Israelite covenant people of God out into the world and preaching this message of repentance and salvation to a whole other nation that has been rebellious against God. And his response is not like, oh, man, that's awesome. This is what happens in chapter 4, verse 1 through 3. This is his why. Jonah was greatly displeased and became furious in response to all these people repenting and believing in God. He prayed to the Lord, "Please, Lord, isn't this what I said while I was still in my own country? That's why I fled toward Tarshish in the first place. I knew that you are a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger, abounding in faithful love, and one who relents from sending disaster. And now, Lord, take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live." That he preaches, they repent, and he's so upset with God and the situation that he says he wants to die. How do you get there? You get there because the people that God called him to preach to were people that he hated. His why is a dirty one. He didn't love these people. He didn't want them to repent. It's obvious. He's upset about it. He doesn't like the result of them coming to know God. He's so upset. He says that he wants to die. The frustration with him is not that he had to go and do this dangerous thing. It's that he knew that God, who is gracious and compassionate, and if they heard about this God and a message that God put on his heart to preach, he thought, if I preach it, they're going to repent. And they're going to be saved. And this hatred, which is probably a mix of some sort of nationalism and racism that's in his heart, led him away from God, and then even whenever he came back and did what God wanted him to do, you can see that root is still there. The why. The why he wanted to run. It's because he didn't love these people. And my question for us is, what is our why? For whatever it is that we need to do, and it may not be as massive, like I said, as going across to another nation. It might be, though, by the way. Maybe it is God's calling you to missions. But it might be something as simple as the thing that I mentioned before. But what is it And why aren't we willing to do it? For me, when I was 14, my why wasn't as much hatred toward the people that I preached to. It was a love of myself above everything else. It's called selfishness. The reason why I didn't want to do it is because I didn't want to do it. I wanted to do anything else. Whenever I was like, all right, God might put this on my heart. There's conviction that maybe he's called me to ministry. This is what I want to do. Anything but that, because it didn't seem fun. It wasn't connected to sports. And it wasn't going to make a lot of money. And at 14, I was like, that's what I want. And this doesn't line up with my wants. Therefore, I don't care if God's called me to do it. I just don't want to do it. Selfishness. And for a lot of us, that might be our why. We know we should read the Bible. We play on TikTok instead. Why? Because we want to. We know we need to share the gospel with that friend. We never get to it. Why? We don't want them to think differently about us, right? Selfishness a lot of times is our root. A lot of times it's our why. And we see in Jonah, there was that, but I think there was definitely hatred for these people, which we'll get to unpack as we get to go through the series. So what are you running from? Two, why are you running? Here's the last question. Will you stop running today? Will you stop running today? So Jonah is eventually going to have to stop running, and we'll really wrestle with some of the nuances of that as we go through it, okay? But he is eventually going to get to the point where he preaches to these people and they repent. So God does a great work through it for his glory and for good of those people. And in my life, this is kind of what happened to me. I kind of had a Peter kind of story. So if you've ever read much about Peter from the Bible, I love Peter from the Bible. You know, some people are like, man, he's like, you know, too hot and cold. I'm like, dude, I understand Peter. You know what I'm saying? I was talking with one of my mentors the other day. He's a pastor, been pastoring forever. He's like, whenever he gets to heaven, he's like, all his buddies, all his pastor buddies are going to be running up to Paul and be like, dude, I loved all your writings. And he's going to be like, I'm going to be hanging out with Pete off to the side and be like, hey, Paul was hard to understand, right? You feel me? You know what I'm saying? He just seemed like a regular dude that loved Jesus. God called him to do some stuff. So I understand Peter, but Peter has this moment when right before Jesus goes to the cross, Jesus said, hey, you're going to deny me three times. And Peter has this big moment where he's like, I'll never do that, right? And then hours later, he's at a charcoal fire with some people. Jesus is on the cross or going to the cross. And during that time, he does deny Jesus three times. He says, I don't even know him. Starts cursing. And then Jesus is raised from the dead, and all the disciples see him, and they believe, and he's kind of showing up a few different times. And at the end of the book of John, we see this moment where one of the last times Jesus meets with the disciples, he meets with them for breakfast. They had been fishing. He met them on the beach, made them breakfast. They're hanging out eating, and he sets up a charcoal fire. It's probably the only two times that word is used in the New Testament. When Peter did it the first time, and in this situation. And at the same kind of fire where he denied Jesus, he asked Peter three different times pretty much the same question. He said, Peter, do you love me? And three different times he said he did. And in that moment, there was this powerful moment of forgiveness and repentance and reconciliation. It's this beautiful thing. But Jesus sets the scene back up for him. He gives him another shot. Did you know God is in the business of doing that for us too? He is a loving and gracious God who he knows we make mistakes, and he makes ways for us sometimes to have another shot at it. So later on in my life, 14 turns into 18. I go through high school. I'm running from this calling. I go to a summer camp, church camp, kind of same kind of deal. And while I'm there, the same thing starts happening, not as much with the weird stuff, but just the conviction that God wants me to be in ministry. And my resolve was weaker, but I still didn't go in thinking I was going to start a ministry. But as I went out through the week and I was kind of halfway a student, halfway serving at this camp, I just felt like the more that I worshiped and pressed into God, the weaker my resolve got. And by the last night of the camp, I just went down to the altar and I remember just praying to God, and I just had this moment of final just submission. I was like, God, I'll do it. Like, if there's anything else, I'd rather do that, all right? But if this is what you want me to do with my life, I'm in. And in that moment, I would love to tell you that at that exact moment, I was like so on fire for Jesus, and I was so excited. If I'm honest, in that moment, it felt like the death of a dream. all that I wanted, I knew I was leaving behind, thinking that that was going to be better for me, but willing to do whatever God called me to do. So I remember having this moment. I told my youth pastor, and he counseled me and all this kind of stuff. But what I found is this. I didn't lose anything that was valuable. All I gained were things like peace and joy and fruit. On the other side of the submission came everything that I was looking for in the wrong direction, right? Like, I found joy and fulfillment and peace and a closeness to God when I finally said, I'll do whatever you want me to do. And on the other side of that submission, on the other side of running from God in that area of my life, really brought the greatest fulfillment of my life, which has been pursuing him since then. Here's what I want you to know. Whatever your running from God area is right now, may it be big or small, whatever waits for you on the other side of your submission is worth it. It's worth it. The peace, the joy, the fruit, the contentment, it's worth it. And the reason is the God of the universe who's calling you to do whatever it is, may big or small in your mind, which, by the way, if you think it's little, it isn't little to God. Whatever it is on the other side of that submission is nothing but the good stuff, man. Will you stop running from one Jonah to another? Will you stop running today? So let me close with this. What can I do with this, all right? What can I do with it? I want to give you a couple things if you already know the Lord today. The first one is this. Define your what. What is it for you? What is the area where you know God's calling you to do something different and you hadn't been doing it? Like I said, it could be a lot of things. It could be forgiveness. It could be sharing the gospel with someone. It could be inviting somebody to church. It could be, I don't know, get involved in a group, unleashing your gifts, being generous. I don't know what it is. What's the thing for you right now? I feel like we all have stuff. But what is it? Just kind of define it in your mind. Hey, I know I need to do this better. Or I know I need to stop doing this. What is it that God's calling me to do? So define your what. And then here's my encouragement to you. Choose the day to stop running from God and run to him instead. Let's just start the submission part week one. Don't wait till the end of the story, right? Just right now, let's get it right. Right now, say, God, I'm coming back to you. I'm going to stop doing that because I know you called me to. I'm going to start doing this because I know you called me to. And I'm going to trust you with my submission. That's the first thing. Here's the second thing. Who is someone God is calling you to tell about Jesus? Who is someone calling you? Share with, right? A lot of times there's a what and a who, right? There's something we need to deal with in our own hearts. There's probably someone we need to carry that gospel to. Who is it for you? I want to encourage you that no matter what your reasoning is for not going, go anyway, right? There's a million different reasons not to go tell somebody about Jesus or invite them to church. Whatever it is, push through it and obey the Lord. Go and share the good news with them, even if it's the 10th time or the first time, okay? And I'll give you this, a little encouragement too, an easy way to get involved as well. So not this coming Sunday, but the next Sunday, we're going to have another fun summer Sunday at the church. We're just going to have a meal or hang out, family time. It's going to be good, okay? So if you need a week to invite, in 2 weeks, invite somebody to come with you. It's going to be awesome, okay? It's going to be a great Sunday. So put that in your mind if you're like, all right, I'd like to invite them to church. That's the week coming up, July 9th. Bring them with you, okay? So go tell and invite. It's usually a what and a who, all right? And here's the last thing. For some of us, it might not be that we have this big, I got to get this right thing with God. But it's more so that you need to believe to be saved. Jonah goes and preaches to these people. And they had not believed in God. That's why he's going to preach to them. And then God does a work, and they believe in him. And he had to think, all right, yes, if God calls me, yes, he's powerful enough to do it, and he's good enough that they might want to follow him. But also there's probably a part of Jonah's heart that was like, these people are terrible people. Maybe they won't receive it. Because a lot of times as human beings, we think the people that are going to be saved are the ones who are the best amongst us. Here's what I want you to understand. The Bible teaches us that is not the case at all. The people that are saved, the people who are going to spend forever with God in heaven, the people who have received eternal life, those are not the best people. Those are simply forgiven people. We are all messed up. We are all broken. We are all needing forgiveness. We all need the grace of God. But the people who are saved, they're simply the ones who believe upon Christ for salvation. Ryan preached this already, Romans 10. But I'll read it to you too. Paul says, for the scripture says, everyone who believes on him will not be put to shame, since there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, because the same Lord of all richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And what it means to call on the name of the Lord here, we're talking about salvation as we're saying this, that I'm going to put the weight of my soul on the finished work of Jesus. Then whenever I put my faith in him, what I'm saying is, I believe that Jesus came, he lived, he died, he rose again. And what he did is enough to save me. I need saving. What he did is enough to save me. I'm putting my faith in him. And here's the good news. That anyone who calls on his name, not the best of us, not the one who have the less of a checkered past, not the ones of us who come to church every Sunday, that none of that's required. But anyone who calls on his name shall be saved. Because we are not saved by what we do, but what Christ has done for us. And we receive that not by works, but by faith. So my question is this morning, is that something you need to do? Do you need to be saved? Are you ready to stop running from God and today run to him? So let's do this. Everybody kind of close your eyes and be still for a minute. If you're already a believer and you're like, man, I know where I am with God, what should I do during this time? I want you to think about this. Wrestle with your what and your why. What is God calling me to do? Why is it hard for me to do it? And choose today to go do whatever it is that God's calling you to do. To say yes. On the other side of our submission, there's joy. There's peace. There's fruit. There's contentment. So wrestle with your what. What am I running for? From? Why am I running? And today, will you stop? But for anyone here today, you're like, man, what I need is I need to be saved. I need to have my sins forgiven. I need to receive eternal life. I need that. And I want to do that today. If that's you today, I want to encourage you to pray something like this in your heart. And these aren't like a magic word prayer or anything like that. This is just hopefully a reflection of our heart of faith back to God. But pray something like this. Say, God, I believe that what Jesus did is enough to save me. His death, his burial, his resurrection. I believe his work is enough to save me. God, today, would you forgive me of all my sin? Would you give me eternal life? Would you call me into your family today? We all have a step. We all have things that we need to stop doing or start doing. But if that was you today, you said, yeah, that's the thing I prayed. I asked God to save me this morning. Then right now with everybody's eyes closed, I just want you just to simply raise your hand. We're not going to acknowledge you or anything. Just say, that was me today. So I can know who to pray for. Amen. 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 Good stuff. All right, so this is what we're going to do. We're going to close with a song. And during that song, we want to encourage you to sing, just worship and praise back to God. Or if you need to pray, maybe God's put some stuff on your heart to pray, feel free to pray in your seats if you need to, or come and grab me. I'd love to pray with you. I'll be in the back, okay? All right, let's stand and let's close with a song. Thank you.
right. Hey, make some noise if you love your church family. Yeah. Man, I love my church. This is like the highlight of my week, getting to come and just be with you guys. Y'all can have a seat. Hey, my name is Joe. I'm one of the pastors here at the church, if you don't know who I am. And I'm just delighted that you're here. And it's just such a sweet time to get together and sit under the truth of God's word and to worship together and just to see how everybody contributes to what we do on Sunday mornings. It's just such a blessing. So we're so glad that you're here. Hey, if this is your first time here at Progression Church, and I always say maybe it's your second or your third time, but you never took the opportunity to fill out the little purple card that you'll find somewhere around you in your seat, I want to encourage you guys, just take a moment to fill that out. It just helps us to know who you are, what brought you here to Progression Church. Because one of the things that we really strive to be is we really want to be not just a church you attend, but we want to be a church that you feel like you belong to and that you feel like you're a part of, this church family. And so if you feel like this is the place for you, that just gives us a chance to kind of help you learn how you can take those steps and join Progression Church and be a part of what Progression Church is doing. And so if you could, fill that out and then just leave it on your chair, leave it info side up on your chair, and then we'll sweep by and we'll pick those up. But that would mean so much to us. We greatly appreciate that. And one of the things that we do just to show our gratitude is we'll send you a gift in your email. So we'll send you a coffee gift card, because everybody loves coffee, unless you're a tea drinker, and coffee places have tea, okay? So we are super duper thankful that you would take your time to fill that out, and we promise we'll follow up with you for a gift just for doing that. We know how it can be giving your info out to people sometimes. Also, we're about to move into a time of giving, and the way we view giving is it's just one of the ways that we worship at Progression Church. Every believer, a follower of Jesus, has been called to be generous. That's what the scriptures tell us. We need to be generous. And so what we think and the way that works itself out in the church is if you consider yourself a part of a church family, whether that's Progression Church or another church that you're like, yeah, that's really my church family, the way that looks is essentially what we'll call a tithe. A lot of people like to use that. A tithe just means 10%. And they'll say, hey, I'm going to give this tithe to my local church to support the mission of getting the gospel out into the city of Baton Rouge, being a part of the mission of the church. And we use it for all kinds of different things. And so we just sent kids to kids camp. We're already starting conversations about, hey, what would it look like for us to be able to take our youth group to a youth camp? Like, we're getting to do all kinds of really cool things with the money that as a church family we collect together. And so that's what we mean by giving when we talk about giving. And so if this is not your church home, don't feel pressure.